Consider supporting ArchaeoSoup on Patreon for as little as $1 per month. Link available in the video description. Thank you.
Welcome back to the A to Z of archaeology. Now today is the letter T, and T stands for toponymy. Toponymy is an attempt to solve one of archaeology's biggest problems.
The problem is time, and the effects of time, the way in which it creates archaeology, divorcing an object from the living environment where it was formed and where it was used. This is the challenge which faces archaeologists. To understand the vibrancy of a gladiator's arena, it would be best if we could interview the people who were there. However, what we are left with are inanimate objects. Sometimes we are lucky and they are very fine, but they cannot talk. Nor can the people who were there to witness the vibrancy of the Roman arena, and the fine objects within are often decayed to a shadow of their former selves.
So, archaeologists need a way to reconcile the difference between the archaeology which is unearthed and the living world which that archaeology came from. This is where toponymy comes in.
Toponymy attempts to understand the processes which create archaeology, the ways in which a living environment changes as it becomes the artifacts and ecofacts which are excavated on a site. For example, toponymy examines how ancient bodies decay and become the burials which are frequently excavated on sites around the world. Toponymy attempts to explain how food goes from being a tasty morsel to being a finished meal and eventually being deposited in a rubbish pit and finally excavated by an archaeologist hundreds or even thousands of years later. This concept can also be applied to other objects, such as ceramics and pots, explaining how they go from being complete objects to being the sherds which we excavate. Or even tools, explaining how it is that the handles of complete tools disappear, leaving only the blades behind for archaeologists to find many hundreds and thousands of years later. And on a grander scale, these ideas can be applied to buildings, explaining the ways in which they decay bit by bit, either through human action, actively destroying a building, or simply by being weathered away until the remains are all that's left. To this end, many observations and experiments have been undertaken to better understand these processes, the way in which a carcass, for example, decays and the bones are scattered around through human or animal action, leaving a selective assemblage for archaeologists, is the subject of immensely detailed study, the way in which certain bones decay, and even the way in which certain parts of the skull are more liable to disappear than others, are the subject of many papers. So-called experimental archaeology often seeks to better understand the ways in which objects break apart. For example, making a traditional 15th century meal in all of the correct ceramics and with the correct foodstuffs, and then burying it to see how long it takes and the ways in which it breaks apart. There have even been studies seeking to understand the way in which modern rubbish decays.
Understanding the processes of decay and the way in which objects change in the ground is only half of the issue. This is where a whole raft of debate comes to the fore, trying to interpret the findings of toponymy.
The eruption of Vesuvius
and the subsequent burial of Pompeii and Herculaneum in AD 79 have proved a battleground for debates surrounding the nature of toponymy. Surely this is a town which is very well preserved. It has been suggested that if we want to better understand the relationship between archaeology and the past, Pompeii is an excellent case study, where even the people themselves are frozen in time. Does this make Pompeii a culture frozen in stasis? Are we able to meticulously reconstruct the everyday life of an average Pompeian? Well, the answer is, of course not. However, some have used Pompeii as a starting point to suggest ways in which we can better understand toponymy. So-called middle range theory attempts to do this. The idea being that if we better understand modern cultures and processes, we can break them down into a series of inputs and outputs, and model how it is that past cultures behaved based upon archaeology. To this end, existing cultures, such as the Inuit, have been studied in great detail. By asking them questions about their forebears and their technology, it is hoped that we can better understand people living in the Ice Age up to 30,000 years ago. However, this approach has been criticized as the Inuit are not a direct analogy to people from the Ice Age. And after all, in the case of Pompeii, is it possible to create an analogy for a volcano erupting and burying a Roman town? It has been suggested that this is like studying Mars by asking questions of the Earth. Another approach has been to understand archaeology as being formed by many different processes. Some are natural, like the action of roots from trees or geology forming, or animals digging through archaeological layers and disturbing the site. Other processes are man-made, such as ploughing a field or perhaps digging a trench which interrupts an archaeological layer. With varying degrees of success, these debates attempt to help us understand how a site goes from being vibrant and living to being the remains which we see and we excavate every day on archaeological sites.
Taphonomy is an attempt to understand exactly what archaeology is and how archaeology is formed in order to better understand the worlds that this archaeology came from. In this way, taphonomy is employed on every archaeological site across the world and every excavation as it's underway. And in some ways, it is almost subliminal. Archaeologists tend to interpret taphonomy without necessarily consciously doing it. We all ask, for example, when we pick up a flint blade, I wonder how the handle was, and you imagine what it looked like. And taphonomy is a formal process of reconciling archaeology with living worlds. So that's been T, taphonomy. Hopefully you found this video interesting and useful, or useful perhaps. Feel free to comment below. Of course, please do subscribe to the channel by pressing the subscribe button above. We do have a Facebook page. All you need to do is search for ArchaeoSoup Productions and click like, and anything that I can't fit onto a video here will make it onto the page on Facebook. And, well, all that's left is to say thank you very much for watching.